Anyway, the changes continue. Another people think, oh, this is a fad, it's going to go away. No, the changes are, they're huge, you know. Like my friend said, just tell him to go look for the North Pole and then get back to me, okay? And if you don't get that, then I guess, you know, maybe you flunked out of geography or something. You know, it boggles the mind. But really what we're talking about here in all this stuff is, you know, we have free will, right? The universe God made, the multiverse, the universe, physics, all the laws of everything God made. Man kind of fritters around it, trying to figure it out, but with a limited, and tries to invent a computer so smart that it makes up for our limited brains now in terms of, but because still the operator is still limited, what he thinks to do is limited. People give so much power to CERN and to, you know, the new D-Wave computer, which is a $20 million computer that ties into the fabric of reality. That's their words, not mine. Okay? It ties in and manipulates the fabric of reality or whatever. People are talking about the Mandela effects and noticing, you know, one to two a day of new ones. That's been about the average for people really looking into it. And, you know, you realize that your Bibles, okay, your, you know, globes, your Bibles, your land, whatever, it's emptiness. There are molecules there that hold a thing together, kind of, but it's vast emptiness. It's easy to manipulate those things. You can manipulate all the Bibles all the way back to the first parchment, if you like. And you can, you know, it's like it's as easy as going and erasing a file off your hard drive. It's no different than that. So people give it so much power. But what I'm amazed at is the spirit of this sort of, you know, well, I'm going to get into this with my guest. That's the best thing to do right now because he's standing by patiently. I had to wait for this whole thing because I played the intro, then I had to play that track because that track really sums it up. You're not you anymore. And now I realize that there's a lot there. I'm gonna get Kenita in here right now. Let's see if we got it, if we're fortunate enough to have him. Charles, are you there?
Yes, I'm here, Jeff. Good morning. Good morning, everyone.
Wow, that you're coming in great. Okay, that is fantastic. I'm excited.
Okay, good.
I've been playing around with this broken wire the whole time. As long as I don't see, but here's the thing: my headphone wire is going underneath it, and I just don't want any trouble.
Oh yeah,
I'm playing this game with the one because I feel, you know, if I'm going to buy a professional wire, because you can buy these at Best Buy unprofessional and they work great and they work forever, nothing ever happens. You go buy a professional audio, pro audio wire, right, for the same thing to plug the
yes.
iPhone into my mixer, okay, and it's by Proco. Yeah, you guys are going to get the Hall of Shame here. And how long did it last? A month? Maybe a month before it started malfunctioning. Just like all our cables when we're in bands and we used to have to set up our mics and everything. We always had to have, you know, it was always good if you had someone in the band who had a soldering iron, right? And had, you know, that little kit.
Yeah.
Because all this pro stuff breaks. Consumer stuff, nope, doesn't break. Pro stuff breaks. And, that's been one of those things in life that I have, you know, I have watched
yeah.
it. And
one of life's little pains.
Well, yeah, it's just the irony of ironies. You know, I want that strong cable, that professional cable. I know it's going to cost me about 200% more in dollars, but I want to make sure that I got a tough cable for the road. And like I say, the cheap cables that you used to buy at not Best Buy, but Radio Shack. They work just great. What I'm using is a...
I remember Radio Shack.
Sure. That was in the old world. You and I were... That was in our old world before we got to this one. Well, Charles...
Oh, yeah.
You know, you've...
I built a little radio once.
I love radios. You know, and it's no mystery to me why I show up here on... You know, this is an airwave, too, but I've... Mics, radios, you know, all that kind of stuff I like. But I've always liked like shortwave, you know, and I haven't really been listening lately because we don't get anything here. But I used to love playing around with the shortwave and seeing what you could dial in from around the globe.
Man. Yeah, okay. I remember those old kits people used to make. You could get stuff everywhere.
Yeah, you get there was a Heathkit radio. There was the Grundig. My grandfather had this big Grundig, and it was like it was a table sitting Grundig, you know, and it had fancy dials, and you know, it had a kind of a warm glow to it, and you could see the where it was, you know, and it was for sitting around and listening, you know, for the days of radio. And it was fun. It was
sure.
It was fun because he had a place up in the mountains where he had it, so it was way up, so you could get all the whole world signals. And my brother and I used to sit there. And we didn't want television. We just wanted to hang around with that radio. So it was.
Oh yeah, yeah. And they were nice, big. They were comforting. You know, people don't realize today a radio was a piece of furniture back then.
Yeah,
I can still remember those radios my grandmother had.
Yeah, you sit around the radio.
They were bigger than the televisions back when the TV came out. Yeah,
well,
everybody did.
Trish
sit
and
around
I
and listened.
Well, Trish and I kind of went back
it's
to
a different world now.
Yeah, we went back to listening to radio when it started, you know, uncovering basically the Clintons. Okay, the Clinton scandals and the Waco thing. Right around that time, Trish and I started like really hanging around the radio again. You know, where we weren't watching that much of the tube, and
yeah.
I don't even watch the tube anymore. It's just like or go to movies or anything. I've just kind of dropped out of the whole thing. But we do, you know, we did gather around the radio, and since that time, about 1993, I put it up to today. It's been a constant listening to radio, and then listening on the internet, and the streaming came in, and then there were hundreds of radio stations, and now YouTube, which is really exciting. You know, anybody who wants to broadcast can broadcast. It is open to the mat. It's great. And then
the
bad guys are trying to stop us.
I'm living proof of that.
Well, you're out there and so many others. I found a guy yesterday, and I can't remember his name right now, but I saved it in my YouTube thing. And he's been doing these shows on, you know, from a God perspective, like from our perspective on the Mandela effect, and kind of ministering to people who might be frightened about it or frightened about, you know, quantum effects or changes, and talking about how there's the people that will acknowledge it and other people with their free will decide if they don't want to wake up, they don't have to wake up. You know what I mean? They can decide not to. And, you know, and he was really, to me, it what was nice about this was he was, you know, saying a lot of things we've been saying, but he's saying to keep our focus on the Lord, which is, of course, we always keep saying that, you know, through this. And then it's not so not so scary. But I don't think people around us have been very, very freaked out. I mean, we've been noticing this whatever this is. And but we've noticed also there's this great anger towards us for having mentioned it.
Yes.
And that's that really is. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's what has stirred me. It was the reactions that we've got, people getting so intensely emotional over what is perhaps their Bible, their God, and not understanding, not seeing this for what it is. This is an attack. It may be an opening salvo of the new war, but this is an attack directly on the body of Christ. And not only directly on the body of Christ, but is also specifically focused on those evangelicals who treasure that King James Version. And there is you can see, I've gone into a couple of the changes that seem to me to be impactful, but what's going on in these things where they are changing things slightly, like womb to matrix, you know, matrix is about forces, womb is about life. They bring different visions into you as you're reading them. The idea of a bottle that can be used again if it's only washed out, and a wineskin that must be renewed. These are little subtle changes.
Very subtle.
That are meant to keep the blinders on, keep these people feeding at the trough of these wolves.
Yeah.
And they're going to be there, and they're going to all of a sudden, they're going to wake up at some point. something is going to happen that's going to resonate with them, and they're going to wake up, but they're going to find themselves isolated, locked in, abandoned. They're going to be the deer in the headlights. And it's because their eyes just simply were not open, because they weren't willing to look, to peel away from their safety zone. And that's become our whole culture, Seth, is that safety zone.
Yeah,
Find it wherever you can and stay there.
It just seems like this is a wake-up call from God. Let's take it from God's perspective, you know what I mean? And he's saying to me, I mean, let me interpret it just a little, get you going with it. It's like he's saying to us, you know, wake up. And in addition to that, you know, I've got this. I am the author of physics. I'm I begin and finish everything. You know, there's nothing that man can do or demons or whoever has these quantum computers or anything that happens outside of my purview, outside my will. No worries. Do not fear. But you need me to get through this. I'm taking you somewhere. I may be far, far away from here. That's what I'm getting. Like, there's just some big thing that's up that we have to be vigilant about. Some big thing that's up that maybe wonderful, actually. And you know, that we need to be attentive, and we need to be giving this word out. You know, Charles, there's a lot of people that they've never seen a Bible before, and they're noticing the effects as well. They don't know anything about Jesus
yet.
They don't know yet, but they will. But they seem to be very friendly and very amenable. If you talk to them, you know, they seem to be like, you know, cool. It doesn't matter if you're, you know, a Jesus freak and they're not at the moment. You both are experiencing the same thing. It almost brings a bond between people that were not friends before. Care to go?
It is. It's the bond of seeing. Their eyes are being opened. And if their eyes are being opened, that means that their heart will follow at some point. And that's where we come into play, by giving them the word, by giving them our, what should I say, the light, the life, the water that flows through us, allowing them to see our life as a life of truth, a life of Christ, a life of the living God, living in his power. These changes come, these changes go. We stand on truth, and truth never changes because it's invested, growing within our hearts. And when they see that, it's a natural magnet as their eyes have been opened. And they'll take a little bit at first, then a little more, and then a little more. And sooner or later, those floodgates will open.
Yeah. Another thing.
And that's why we're here, Zach.
Yeah, well, absolutely. I'm here for the Lord. I can't think of anything to do here because, I mean, I'm doing stuff, but I mean, I don't really have I have a couple of goals, but it's more like trying to be a better person and, you know, stuff like that. I don't really know what I would do if I said, well, let's say we could start over again. You're 21 years old, you know, okay, what do you want to do? You know, or you're 15 or whatever, you know, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I just can't think of a thing. And the reason I can't think of anything, I mean, it's not because this is what my mother, this drove her nuts. You know, I had no ambition. and because I said, because time is moving and because death is coming and everything is transitory. I can't think of anything because it would just crumble. And I feel that way again nowadays. You know what I mean? Like I see things moving so fast that it's hard to settle down and plot a path, you know, one of our own plans, you know, to plot our path. We want to go do this. We want to go. It's almost like, well, wherever God flings us, that's where we'll go serve. You know what I mean? If he has to fling.
Yeah. I think we have to give up the plotting.
The plotting, it does. It's like, well, what are you going to do? What kind of life are you going to have? And here you are. Here's the world. And it's a brand new day. What are you going to do, sonny boy, when you grow up, you know? And I want to be a fireman, they would say in grade school. Yep. You know, I want to be an astronaut. I want to be a rock star. I want to be a famous actor. I want to be a scientist. I want to, you know, blah, 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 blah. And I just, it's like it
sure.
was. I can't even imagine. I can't think that way. Right now, I'm incapable of thinking like, let's say I have 10 years left on the planet. I mean, I'm not going to limit it because I feel I'm unlimited. I don't believe in death, especially my own. But still, it's like, okay, I want to be a sound wave, you know, and get in the flow of things. You know, I want to be in the flow of God, let's say. I want to be like, okay, I'm ready to be, let God, like the word is fling us into this adventure. We're in this adventure right now with these quantum changes. And the Lord, he showed me yesterday, I just bounced this off you. He's laughing at people that take this really serious, that people that think that man's computers or man's little, you know, pea shooter collider can do anything. You know, if they're going to do something, he'll allow it to happen so it will bring about his finishing of the finishing work that's going on here. And then he'll just eliminate the entire universe and put us on a new course, and that'll be that. I mean, poof, it's gone.
Amen. That's exactly what's happening. That's exactly what's happening.
Yeah, man.
And the reason we don't get upset and worried about it and other people is because, well, I don't know how to phrase it exactly, but it's because we've been in the fire. We've lived our life in that fire. Uh-huh. We know the living God. We know what is coming. We see what's happening around us. We understand what they're doing, this little pea shooter over in Europe that throws these particles together. I understand. God revealed to me how they're trying to break this hole open. That,
yep.
You see, according to the laws of quantum physics, they understand now the reality of the spirit world because they can prove its existence.
Yeah.
Perhaps even multiple spirit worlds. And they can prove their existence because of quantum reality and the experiments that they can do within our single dimension. And what they're trying to do is at the smallest level, since they know that all things, including from the smallest particle up until including us, exist in each of these levels simultaneously. Mm-hmm. As they annihilate this small particle, they can, for that however brief time, pull these worlds together and put a rip in that veil. And that's how they're using these computers to insert these changes that go back beyond time, because they're creating small ripples in time. Mm-hmm. In these quantum computers that are vastly superior to anything we know of, mm-hmm. are actually targeting these ripples to create what they want in this new world. And God is allowing it because this is the separating of the wheat from the tares. We're beginning to see that now.
I see that now. Yeah. Well, anyway, yes. With all this physics, you know, we've all taken a physics lesson recently, right? And God's
we've had to.
God's like our best physics teacher because he's like, but wait a second. It's above the real reality that they can't see. It's above your ability to.
But his world.
It's above you. You can't comprehend what it really is, and neither can they. Even with the D-Wave computer, it's as powerful as a billion brains. Okay, that's what they said anyway on their website. A billion brains, and they're located in Vancouver is where they make the D-Wave. It's not exotic, folks. You can all go look it up and go to. It's called dwavesys.com. And you can go ahead and just read their website. And if you want one of those computers, it'll cost you $20 mil. Okay. So if you got an extra $20 mil, you can buy one and you can start playing with Bible changes or whatever.
Of course, they got to realize that anything the government is willing to let people sell to us is 20 to 30 years behind what they have.
Right. So they're able to mess around. God's allowing them to mess around with, you know, to get our attention. But then you know, I feel like, you know, I've looked at Anthony Patch's work recently, and he's probably the best one in terms of trying to put a biblical, you know, Bible prophecy, you know, take on what's happening now. And it involves Saturn and the portal and letting the beings out and having them run around and, you know, wreak havoc. And then he also talks a bit about Project Bluebeam and having the alien saviors, right? We are your progenitors. Mm-hmm. We are your ancient parents. Come, we'll save you. And I actually had a dream last night of this big ramp that they were having humans walk up into the ramp into like a container. It was going to go off in outer space or something. And I was kind of excited about it in a way until it kind of reminded me of the train to Auschwitz, you know what I mean? After a while. And so I got away from it. I was like, wait a second, guy. They're deceiving you. Don't get on that ramp. Don't do that. This is, it was tempting, very tempting.
It's Satan's counterpart. You know, it's Satan's counterfeit of the Stairway to Heaven of Jacob.
Jacob's
and
ladder.
The angels up and down escorting. You know, it's his counterfeit. But people got to remember, you know, we've seen visions of this in the past, you know. Do you remember, what was it? It was a Twilight Zone episode where they came down and they had a book to serve man. At the very end, they found out to serve man was a cookbook.
It's a cookbook. I love that.
Yes. And they're getting ready to jump in the pot right now as we speak.
Well, when I was 15, I wrote a story, and I've talked about this on a podcast, about manipulation of dimensions and winding up in different dimensions through, you know, through self-will, let's say. It was pretty advanced for a teenager, you know, but it just means that I've always been kind of tied into what's going on now. It's almost like everything that's now is, my whole life has been leading, probably your mileage is probably pretty similar. Everything seems to have been leading up to being alive now. At this crescendo time.
Yes. You know? Yes, we were prepared for this time, Zeph. I've been speaking that for years. We're not here by accident. We are locked and loaded and ready when we came into this world for this time.
Yeah.
I believe that with all my heart.
Because why would I at 15 be messing around with other dimensions and thinking about things like that? Why? But now it comes in handy, right? Because now it's like, oh.
Yes.
Oh, I've been dealing with this my whole life. In the Zeph Report, too, it seems that I've been trying to tell people that reality, you know, I got criticized, you know, now I laugh at it. I mean, at the time, I didn't understand in 2002, but now I, you know, obviously I don't care what people say. But that they were saying, Zeph doesn't believe.
Well, you know, we didn't, none of us really understood. As their eyes were being opened to these possibilities, so were ours at the same time. A lot of us didn't think in terms of other dimensions, but it's always been there in the Word. You know, when our Lord talked about kingdom, he says he's building a mansion, he's not talking about a little house out in the garden.
Yeah, it's a dimension.
He's talking about whole new realms and dimensions.
Right, right, right.
Yes, that are all going to be interconnected through New Jerusalem, and it'll be a whole new vision, a whole new world that we can barely imagine. And so the whole ideas of dimensions and new reality speaks to that part of us in our heart that's been taken over by him. We just can't resist it. We're drawn to it.
Yeah, let me put it this way. It's a lot better than this situation right now that we're in. Right? It's not even you can't compare the two. It's like comparing, you know, the sun and a rock on Earth or something. It's like there's, you know, there's that's the difference. And you know, it's so much more that you can't talk about it because it's just too much. And but let's just
the one thing I know the one thing I know for sure is we won't even need the sun, Zeph, because
amen,
the light of
brother.
God will be so overpowering and overwhelming, and it will exude not only from God but from us as well.
Of course it is.
It'll be a world of all light.
Of course it is. That's exactly
beyond what, our imagination. It's
and it has to be that he gives us the power. We're like electricity. I mean, we have our own. We are a power source. We are a co-creator. We are a joint heir in Christ. We are all those things, and so we have that freedom.
Well, we are God in the sense that He is there within us.
Right, right on.
We are Him in the sense that He is there within us. We become what we were always meant to be.
Well, I hath not seen nor ear heard.
I can't hardly wait.
I know you're making me. It's like. Well, when does this movie come out? I want to be there on day one, and I want to be there. I want to be there the first screening.
Me too.
Yeah, that's what I want to see. Those are the feelings I'm having. You're having. Other people are having. Everyone all over the place. The guy that I don't even know on YouTube. Just a guy at 3 a.m, right? You see a guy at 3 a.m. He does a half hour YouTube.
That's right.
He hits every point just right on, you know, just like, wow, that was like mana, you know, and he's talking to me and I'm like, we're on the same page, and all these new people that I haven't seen before, we're all on the same page. And then we have this other thing, this resistance, but it doesn't look like that resistance is going to grab onto us, not this time. And I'm not sure what that means prophetically, but
No. They're
not going to be able, their objections, you know, to us looking around or whatever, which is almost
once
sick.
The vision comes to people, the fear no longer has a place to grab a hold. Once they see the vision that you and I have seen, that we've lived in, once they experience the fire for themselves, fear is gone.
Yeah, there's no fear about
You've
this.
Seen reality.
There's no fear. I'm just, you know.
No.
I tell them, take a look at Greenland, and they go, it's always, take a look at the North Pole. Oh, it's always been like that. I'm like, I thought there was a North Pole up at the North Pole. No one told me it was just water. I mean, you know, is that fair or is that a cheap shot? If you just say go check out the North Pole, then get back to me, you know, and then they don't even.
I think a lot of times
they don't know what to do.
No, I mean, they want you to see what they see.
I don't see.
That's what it is. So often they want you to see what they see.
They're not seeing. That's the whole point. They're not looking. They're not seeing.
That's the point. Yes.
They think this is a fixed reality here, and that nothing changes, and we're all going through this. And what you see, what you perceive, is what's really real. And that's, you know, that's the biggest scam of all, to get you to buy into it and then be afraid. Of course,
it is.
Be afraid, and then out of your fear, they'll give you Jesus, but that's not the real Jesus. You know what I mean? And then you, out of a fear, we cling and we predict horrible things are going to happen to us, and we just clamor around in these tiny little groups, and we hate everybody outside the group. I can't stand that. Obviously,
no, and it is out of that fear that those terrible things are going to happen to them.
Yeah, because they're being used.
It's because of the fear that separates them from God.
They're being used to bring it about in a way. You know, it's like they're computers, but they can't see
yes,
that.
Yes, they are.
So what's in them is like a quantum computer, and they're being programmed to bring about what Satan wants, which is a big bloodbath, you know, just like what happened in Bangladesh, only over the whole world, right? That's
yes.
And they're huddling.
Only those who are participating in it, those especially who claim Christ who are participating in this, will find that the bloodbath that they enter will be their own.
They're going to have their own bloodbath, and they're going to be looking for the way out. And, you know, because every day is a leap, Charles. Have you noticed that in time? It's almost like time is compressed to where, like, tomorrow is like 5 years further, and the next day is another 10. It's like things happen that used to take a lot of time.
Yes.
Now they're just instantaneous.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Time has been sped up exponentially. I think that's a part of the plan. It's a part of keeping man agitated and confused and irritated and divided and warring against himself. You can see their plan throughout history. You can see it, that what they've done to us as a nation. When I was a child, there were only Americans, but then they began giving us labels, you know, Black Americans, White Americans, Spanish Americans, mm-hmm. Native Americans, rich Americans, poor Americans, yeah. Fat Americans, skinny Americans. And they gave us each special interest groups, and they got to warring against each other. And now you can't find any three people in this country that can agree on anything.
Or that have an IQ.
Because we're at war with each other. And
yeah.
They've taken this.
Amen.
They put this now into the church by making these subtle changes, bringing it about, fomenting all of this disturbance. And they're doing it to weaken us for the assault that is about to take place. People are so busy fighting over something silly and stupid that they can't see the tidal wave 20 feet away.
Yeah.
And they're going to be washed away from their own blindness.
Yeah.
It's all right there.
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
It destroys me thinking about that.
Well, that's hard because you see it's coming in and they're sitting there doing nothing. And they're just chewing their cud, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They're in their little cage and they're chewing their cud. And they've been dumbed down to the point of being zombified, and they're gone. I mean, they're gone. They may go to church and whatever, but they're gone. We need people to actually, you know, there'll be a calling of people. I think back, I've seen this for 15 years, and that is, that one day the Lord's going to wake up those churches. He's going to, I called it the Elijah, yes. The Elijah factor, right? It's like Elijah's going to go clean up the churches. You know, that Elijah's spirit's going to go in and just purge all that mess, all that complacency, all that malaise, all that lust and lying and, you know, all the kind of festering demons that are in there, and just clean it out. And like you said, like what you're saying, they're going to wake up one day, right? And some are going to wake up with this, but I mean, there's going to be people going into those churches. I mean, I'm not being called to do this, but there are some people here and there that will be called to serve in the, among those bodies, right? They'll be like the only one who can see in a mass body of people, but their presence alone, and this is what I want to tell these brothers out there, your presence alone, and sisters, your presence alone will do it. It's not like you have to go in there and perform.
Yes, it will.
So that's what I'm seeing that too, and that's exciting as well. That, hey, the Lord is going to reconcile everything to himself ultimately anyway in the end. I mean, there's nothing separate from God ultimately, and the ultimate whatever, all there is just a...
Oh, yes.
There just is God, you know. There's nothing separate from him. So one way or another, he's going to get our attention, right?
Ultimately, this journey is a journey from God to God. You know,
right.
Ultimately.
We went a
journey from God through God to God.
Yeah, we left. We got our asses kicked. We came back. We had to really go on an adventure just to get back. And we have free will. We had the, I guess, we're in some other realm or some other thing. There's mythology about the fallen angels and, you know, the rebellion and all that. To me, that's a lot of that is mythology, but it speaks to a certain truth. We fell away, probably due to rebellion, and I don't know what form we were in. I don't really know the details, okay? But it feels like, I'll just give the intuition here. We fell away, and then God provided the way, and God's bringing us back. Because ultimately, we don't want to be separate from God, right? I mean, we had the right to do so through free will and what he created. And then we realized that nothing can really exist apart from God. Nothing can be content apart from God. Nothing can be anything but a fallen. The further you get away, the more fallen you become, until we find these people upon the earth, these leaders, these rulers who are against God all day long. And you look at them and you go, God, are they stupid? Is that what it is? Are they just dumb, or maybe it's not their time yet? Maybe
I think it's more than that, Zeph. It's got to be more than that.
Well, what do you think it is?
It's got to be more. I think that it's a willfulness within man that causes him to do this. It's a desire within man. To be in control, to be the creator, to be himself, God Almighty. And I think that's what it is. And coming here is a means of breaking us, I think. You know, the consistent thing you'll hear in the testimony of everyone who ever walked with the living God was he was broken first.
Yeah.
And when you are broken, there's something primal that comes out of you, and something else even more primal that is put into you, and you begin to see the world in a wholly different way. You don't see yourself as the center of existence. You don't see your needs being the center of all of your impulses. All of a sudden, there's something new. There's that breath of life that's been implanted within you. And, you know, I don't know. I couldn't prove this by scripture, but I believe when God breathes into us, he breathes a word into us as well. And I think it's two words. I think he breathes covenant and kingdom.
Amen.
Into us. Covenant as a way of identifying ourselves. The covenant from, I'm not talking about Old Testament or covenant. I'm talking about pre-existence covenant. You know, the Bible tells us Christ as the bride price was sacrificed before the foundation of the world. Yeah. If that's true, then there must have been a betrothal covenant between us and Christ, where that price was established.
Where do you think we were?
To the covenant, and he became bound to us. What's that?
I'm dying to ask you this. I mean, I'm living to ask you this. Sorry. No, I'm not dying. I'm just take that, strike that. Okay. Where do you think we were? Just, you know, speculations. Where do you think we were? What you know, before the foundation of the world? Where were we? In the heavens?
We were somehow in the mind of God, whether we were formed individually to where we knew each other individually. I'm not certain yet. I think we probably must have, because God differentiated out.
We had to
betrothed from those who were not betrothed. I think that you see it written in the Word, and you know how God places things just in odd places around His written Word. In Samuel, we're told that a way is made for those banished from God to not be separated from God.
Yes.
A way is made for them back. And I think that's all about this covenant. We were covenanted as His bride, then set out for a testing and a breaking in order to truly be formed into that bride. As His betrothed, we are legally bound, covenant bound to Him. And these words of covenant give us that inter-identity when we are brought back to life. And the word kingdom gives us a destiny that we can look forward to. It's the vision that we shared before of what kingdom really is. Kingdom in this world is a walk without fear, a walk without want, a walk without need, a walk in power. But kingdom in its whole fulfillment is a whole new life, a whole new way of being, back into the living God from where we came. And it's the identity and the promise, the destiny that gives us our hope. It gives us our power. It is everything. Once you see it,
you should have been on that.
Have nothing less.
Yes. You should have been on that pulpit. I think everybody out there, wouldn't you love to be in church with this guy? Huh? How would that be? I mean, then you wouldn't be going to sleep then, would you?
The church won't let me there, Zeb. I was there once. They drove me out.
I mean,
they said I was insane. And I am. I'm crazy for God. I'll admit it.
Well, but you, to me, you're the sanest guy in the room. But then again, I don't have much credibility in that department either. Anyway, so that's funny. Oh gosh. But I just was imagining while you were talking, because you put it so nice. You just make me, and I'm sure all the other listeners, you just make us want to jump into God right now. You know, just no fear, no looking back, no back and forth. Just let's go, you know? And that's the feeling
I get. That's the way it's done, you know? That's the way it's done. You want to get in the river of life, you strip everything off, and you jump in. You don't stick your toe in, then go in a little bit, you dive in. Take it all.
Amen. I love it.
You are consumed.
I love this talk today. This is just the most, it's wild. I can't put it into words, the feeling I have, but it's like, the gates of heaven opening. I can see, you know, I can see what you're talking about.
A flow, Zeb. There's a flow.
Yeah.
There's always a flow when two get together in His name, always a flow. And then there's others in with us, and it's all of us together, and it amplifies it. You know,
Do you think we
so much more than what it would be with just one of us?
Do you think we agreed to come here, and do you think we agreed to wake each other up? Could that be it? Because I've always thought that people in my life that, you know, are so unlikely that we would be friends. It seems like I've known them, you know, and I wonder if, you know, like I kind of woke them up on something, then they might email me with something, and that kind of wakes me up in a way a little more. And I just wonder if, you know, if we knew each other, I'd say I'm probably about 70-80%. That's what I think. You know what I mean? I can't prove it, but that's how it feels to me, like we knew each other. And then the other thing is, so we must have been differentiated, not just all one block of consciousness. And then if so, did we leave? You know, we're here. Here's another thing. We're here at a certain time in history, quote unquote. And isn't it interesting that we're here right now? Well, I mean, These changes, I mean, the woman, actually the woman that coined the term Mandela effect, really is a secular, you know, I'm not sure what she believes in or anything else, but she says that there's always been portals and, you know, reflecting pools and things with reality and all that. But I beg to differ. She says that it's probably been going on forever. I don't believe that. I believe that what we're seeing now is
well, there have been changes going on.
Yeah.
There have been changes going on, but not this type of change.
Not
this
like
is
this.
A,
right.
What's happening now is a blending of realities. There's a blending of realities as one reality is trying to take over our conscious mind out of the reality of God. And what you're seeing is this kind of blending, and it's bringing the chaos and the division. It's interrupting that flow that goes naturally between people.
Oh, division. Yeah, well... You know, I used to write, like, I used to use the word season, like I call it the mean season and this season, that season, whenever, when I was writing in inspirational words and stuff. And so now I used it again. I said, this is the season of division. And it just really is.
Because
I mean, it's not, and I'm trying to tell people, it's not like it's my fault. It's not your fault out there. You know what I mean? Things are just being separated from us automatically without anybody doing anything. It's just, it's automatic division. It's not in our control. And that's what I want people to understand. It's like, not, you know, you shouldn't be shamed for behaving one way or shamed for behaving another way. This division is going to happen whether we like it or not, whether we're good or not, whether we're just really Christ-like or not. It doesn't really matter. It's going on. It's the, and there's nothing we can do about it.
So it was all in his...
Okay.
That's right.
Well,
it's all in his timing, Zeph. You know, not only were we caught at this time, so were they. Listen to the words out of Proverbs. There is a generation that curse their father and bless not their mother. There is a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet are not washed from their filthiness. There is a generation, oh, how lofty are their eyes and their eyelids are lifted up. There is a generation whose teeth are as swords and their jaw teeth as knives to devour the poor from off the earth and the needy from among men. Mm-hmm. We are the needy. We are the poor. Mm-hmm. This generation has shown up right on time, just like we have. We're all here to raise the glory of us and to them in their own way.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all coming down now.
It's all coming down now. It's fasten your seatbelts. You know, be attentive to God. I mean, no 2 days are the same anymore. And, you know, the sensitive among us have been able, the people who have visions and things, we've all kind of, you know, woken up at this time. I also know people that they don't see any changes in the Bible, and they say that they're saying that it's a test to see if you're going to stay the course, and that if you really have committed the Bibles to your heart and you remember the scripture the way it was, and someone was talking about this to me on, I don't know where it is, these social networks, and you know, trying to say that this is a test, and I'm not going to fail the test, and this is what the Lord, you know, this person was not condemning me, but they were saying they're staying the course. I think it was on the Lord's Prayer, or whatever it was, and they remember it exactly the way it is now, and there's been no change, and they're not going to be swayed by the strong delusion of the quote Mandela effect or quantum effect. And that's just where they are. And they seem like sweet souls, you know what I mean? But they're blind as a bat in a way. In other words, if they don't see that, my question is, let me scratch that and start again. My question to this person and to people like you, do you notice anything else, you know, like the way you feel, the light of the sun, the globe in particular with certain land masses, do they look the same to you? And any products, do you see anything at all that would show a more fluid reality rather than a some kind of whatever you think it is? And if the answer is no, that you don't see anything, that there are no changes in the Bible, I'm assuming that what you're telling me is that, you know, the Lord's Prayer is what it is and that's solid, but throughout the rest of the Bible, because there's one or two of these a day, so you're going to have to keep busy, you know, refuting them all. And so the whole Bible, you've seen, are you saying that you see not even one change in the entire, the Bible itself is God, the Bible itself is holy, the Bible itself is to be worshipped. Is that what you think, that God can't have his word chained. God will not ever let anyone attack his word. God's word stays forever. So therefore it's being attacked. I think part of this is God's judgment because, you know, he's punishing, obviously, people that think the sola scriptura. But I told you there was a danger with the sola scriptura thing, with the Martin Luther approach. If you took it quite literally, that scripture becomes your God. You know what I mean? A written Bible becomes your God. And then, you know, you're going to defend that because mm-hmm. If you think that can't be changed, because the word of God is God, and it never changes, so God is God, right? But if you think the Bible can't be changed, that you, so there's so many people, Charles, that call this Bible, the Bible itself, the King James Version, is the word of God. So God would never allow that to be touched. And that's,
yes,
that's right there. I was always disagreed with that. But I'm seeing the fruits.
When I hear people say that to me, the first,
yeah, go ahead.
The first thing comes to mind is Gideon's ephod. That's what their Bible has become. It has become Gideon's ephod. Mm-hmm. He set up something to bring the people together to remind them of their great victory. And the people began worshiping the ephod instead of the God who gave them the victory.
Okay.
You can read that in Judges, anybody that wants to go look. And that is what they put their Bible to become. Their Bible has become their Lord. And these changes, as I said, some of them so subtle that they won't notice, are meant to fit in with these new theologies that their pastors have been preaching for the last 10 years, where they've actually taken the real God out of the scriptures as much as they could. And these people that are blind because their whole vision comes from within their own little fellowship there. They're, you know, if the pastor says it, it must be true. They break their Bibles only as much as to read the scripture on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and they think they're Bible scholars. And the truth is, they don't know the word of God because they've never known the God that wrote the word. And if it's not on your heart and just in your memory, it's just a phantom. It comes and goes.
Yeah, so my question is, are you saying you see no changes? Because I remember I had Mike S. on here, and he poo-pooed the whole thing out of hand. But since that time, there's been a lot of others. So if Mike is listening, I mean, I know you're,
yeah.
I know you're mad at me, Mike, but I'm not mad at you because I'm not mad at anyone. So I'm mad at Obama. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Obama, for your terrorism. You know, are you saying that now that there's been a few more changes, are you saying categorically, Mike S, you can, you know, write me or something, you know, are you saying that in the future, I mean, from where we were before, where we talked about this on the air and you felt that the people in the chat room beat you up or whatever, and they were just disagreeing with you. They weren't really beating you up, but, you know, everyone has their own perspective. Are you saying that from now on, it's all bogus and there are no changes in the future, so you're not even going to look at it? Or are you saying that, are you looking at it and giving it another look? You know, there's also, I mean, are you saying you're not ever going to look? Or are you saying that you're automatically there to refute anything that anyone says? It's always been, because he refuted the thing with me where he said it's always been bottles. Here, this Wikipedia here, I found a sermon that someone gave on the bottles, you know, in 1987. So that proves it. I'm like, that doesn't prove anything because everything has changed front and back. This is a different reality, a different dimension, a different timeline. So are you saying that...
Right.
That you don't notice anything at this date now that this thing has escalated? Or are you saying that the delusion has escalated, you're going to stay the course, and you're going to be good in God's eyes? I mean, is that what you really think? That you're staying out of strong delusion and everyone else, we're just all crazy and strong delusion, and we need to repent? Is that what you're saying? And you're not going to look at anything that happens? You know, it's going to get very,
you know, there will be those that do that.
I know, they're going to choose. They can choose.
There will be those.
With their free will, they can choose to not notice anything. I'm looking at it this way. I'm not just looking at the Bible. It is inspiring to me. I mean, obviously, we just wrote a song about it, you know, Rich and Me, and that was like one of our best songs ever, and very simple song, very, you know, nothing strained. We both had fun with it. You know what I mean? It wasn't like, let's come up with something. It was just like this natural, just kind of like two kids playing, you know, just having some fun, just kind of like venting what we've been going through. And I think those kind of songs are the best songs because it's just like captures a moment, you know, snapshot in time. And no big deal, right? We weren't trying to impress anybody or anything, but it turned out to be, you know, a really top track. For at least I really like it. And usually, I mean, I'm kind of ambivalent when, if you work in the studio and you hear something 100 billion times, you're like, you know, you don't get the you don't get the enjoyment of hearing it for the first time. You know, you've got to kind of let it go away for a couple months and then come back and listen, and then you can get some fun out of it. But anyway, so we did a song about it. And then I had another song before that about the Mandela effect, just kind of like having fun with, you know, making a little bit of a satire out of it. You know, poking fun at myself as well. What I'm trying to say is I don't write songs unless I'm inspired. You know what I mean? So it's like something going on, you know, that it's affecting my life and affecting what I write. And it's also affecting my spiritual life. I feel much more intensely focused on the Lord than ever before. And it's not like a will thing. It's not like I'm using my will to, I'm really going to tune in now. You know, no, it's not that. It's like I've been just automatically brought closer. You know, and as I see that we're not in the right place in the galaxy, you know, there's that. Have you looked at that? Oh, God. You know, are we in the Milky Way? Where are we? You know, just, you know, why is the sun, you know, really white and bright? I don't remember that exactly. Why is the sun rising in the northeast, not the east? You know, what's going on around here? You know, you can look at it on that level. But to me, it's like everything is quickening. You know, this love of this agape love, this kind of electrical love is starting to manifest. And I'm like, you know, I've been pretty cynical. I'm like the last guy that's going to be in the, you know, having a love bomb happen, you know, and yet it's happening.
Yeah.
It's happening. I mean, the hearts
we're being moved. We're being moved, Zap. We're being positioned for where we need to be for these events to happen. Mm-hmm. And even those people that are hardening their hearts, that are building the walls and they don't want to take them down about these changes and stuff, They're being moved into where they'll be positioned, because so many are going to be blindsided. Our Lord said himself, he is going to come like a thief in the night for most people. And he's not talking about unbelievers. He's talking about believers, people who claim his name. It will be woefully, totally unprepared. I mean, the tribulation saints have to come from somewhere, you know, and that's going to be where.
So that now let's tune into Revelation 7 and 14. Now, you know, we get in these chapters, we get this view of the tribulation saints having gone through the tribulation and then being around the throne of God. In other words, they were martyred for their belief. And then clearly, you know, in the scriptures, it says that the saints will be overcome for their testimony, and in the book of Daniel, it says the saints will be worn out. You know, so we have a lot of, you know, Old and New Testament, especially the book of Revelation, where it's just really clear that these believers of God, these people in, I guess, from the churches, these people that have been overcome for their testimony will be executed. Is that right?
Yes.
For their faith?
Yes. These will be the people that will come out. They've been the first, you know, the first of these changes that everybody that talks about these changes isn't talking about is the change that went from believers preparing for the coming of Christ to believers believing they're going to be raptured and taken out, that came in about 150 years ago and was nowhere to be found in any preaching of any church prior to that. That was the first fundamental change that came in and swept across these churches like wildfire. And what it did was it made them woefully unprepared for the times that are about to come, because they didn't think they'd be here. And nobody prepares for what they don't expect to experience.
And they believe they would be raptured.
And all of these people, Mike.
Mike.
That's right. Mike believes in the rapture. So Mike has a vested interest in denying all of these changes.
See, you know,
even though he doesn't recognize it.
You know more about Mike than I do.
That doctrine.
You know more about Mike than I do.
What's
that? I'm running into people, they know more about Mike than I do. Well, I didn't know that. I never talked to him about that. Whatever did I talk to him about? I just thought he was...
Well, I listened to his show a couple of times after he was on with you.
Yeah, okay. Okay. I see. And so he was into the rapture, the pre-tribulation rapture? Is that it, or...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he was a firm believer in that we wouldn't be here. And see, that clouds their vision. They cannot see what is coming because of that wall that they have erected of a false doctrine, and God will not allow them to see through it until it's blasted out of existence by the fact that they can no longer deny that they're in the middle of the tribulation. Then, well, their eyes will open.
Yeah, it's going to be, I warned people. I said, you know, a lot of these people that believe in a pre-trib, I didn't say no. You know, I here's what I've seen. Okay, I'll just cut to this. And I'm not the only one, but I saw something. This was a vision, like when, you know, there was going to be a nuclear war, and when this blast came or whatever, that was the rapture, if you will. We were just taken away. And, you know, I don't know. That would be, I guess, right. That would be in the middle of tribulation. But we were with God, and it was just the strangest thing because everyone's going to die, you know. And then I've seen that there's been, God can sweep people away. God can take people out of here anytime he wants. And he does. And that happens. And it actually happens, you know, and when it does happen, usually people have no memory of that person ever having been here because it's like a dimensional shift. And so there's that kind of thing that goes on that I've been aware of, but I haven't really focused in on it too much. I haven't really thought that much about, you know, a rapture, but I have thought about, because the Lord told me, you know, and I'll say it today. I just kind of, this is something I don't like to talk about, but you know, that, you know, you won't see death. Now, even if I died, that could be true, you know, because we go from life to life, you know, and it's a touchy subject, but we might as well get into it about death. And I have thought at times that, well, maybe we're dead here and, you know, God's going to take us away, you know, God's going to take us home. And I've had so many different kinds of concepts about it, you know, and and that a lot of the demonic things, what we see, are trying to remind us how this is a fallen world, how we need to get on with our Lord, because this is not our home. You know, then the more demonic activity and the slayings that we're seeing, and the, you know, the Bangladesh thing and hacking people to bit with swords and making it as bloody and awful as possible keeps reminding me that this is not my, obviously, this is not something I can, this is not a world that I can even take seriously anymore. I really have to get on with the Lord, you know, because this is just,
yes,
a bunch of stupid barbarians hacking each other to death. I mean, you know, that to me, that's hell. I mean, that right now, what we saw in Bangladesh is hell. And I'm sorry for the people that lost their lives because they didn't know the Quran. It's been the three Americans were slain, and they enjoyed showing pictures and smiling and doing YouTubes. And all I can say is I have a new hashtag. Spread this one around, folks. It's hashtag thanks Obama exclamation point. You can put an exclamation point on the end of it. I don't know if it's good, but it's thanks, Obama. So whenever you see a terror attack, whenever you post a thing about a terror attack, thanks, Obama. And I know that some people believe, and I don't know what I think exactly, but I'm covering it. Some people believe that Obama is that man of sin, that lawless one. They believe in a singular human antichrist character that's going to be indwelt with Satan himself and have a short period of a pathetic rule and be brought down, but after much, much violence and death and much chaos and much horror and pain and every awful thing you can imagine, is Obama that guy? I mean, you don't have to answer. I'm just throwing it out there.
You know, I'm not willing to put a claim on Obama as that guy just yet because he hasn't quite done those things that will sing. Signally identify him. Plus, you know, Obama, he shows some signs of it. He certainly is a bringer of death. He's certainly a raiser of taxes. He's certainly a bringer of division and divisiveness, and there's a darkness about him. But the Antichrist will rise out of nowhere, like Obama did, like Bill Clinton, like Jimmy Carter, like even Trump. But he's going to be wildly popular. That's the thing. His policies are going to start out working. He's going to draw the whole world together by his own charisma, by his own policies, that are going to lift.
That's not Obama. I'm sorry.
Hitler took over.
Yeah, that's not Obama.
No, that's not Obama. Okay, when Hitler took over Germany, Hitler was wildly popular in Germany because he restored the economy. He restored jobs. He restored national order, and he restored some sense of pride within the German people. Mm-hmm. The Antichrist is going to do those things.
Wow.
So that's what really blocks me from seeing Obama as the Antichrist.
Or Trump.
The Antichrist is going to be brilliant.
Trump is also...
that doesn't cover Obama at all.
It doesn't cover Trump either. So it's like... yeah, it's
no.
We don't even know if Trump...
I only throw Trump in because I say... I only throw him in only because I say the Antichrist will be like that in the sense that he'll rise out of nowhere.
Out of nowhere, yeah.
This man will suddenly come on the scene. That was my analogy to those... That's happened more and more often, you see, in our country in the last few elections. We've not elected seasoned people. We've elected people that suddenly sprouted out of nowhere. And one day that's going to happen, and it's going to be this guy. Mm-hmm. And our people are being conditioned for that by the very things that are going on in our political scene now and across the world, the upheavals. Somebody's going to take advantage of these upheavals. They're going to ride a wave, and they're going to show up ready to go. And that's going to be your man.
Okay, well, then we're going to be on that watch. I just feel like things are quickening so quickly. You know, it could be something like this would also fit if there's a catastrophe, just a horrible global crisis. And then out of that,
sure.
And out of that
sure.
comes this guy out of nowhere, you know. But Erdogan, the Turk, people compare him to Hitler. He ain't going to make it either, you know. So, okay. So we'll just.
No.
It's.
I can't see any member of Islam making that treaty with Israel and allowing them to destroy the Dome and the Rock and rebuild their temple. I find it hard to find that someone of that faith would do that and still maintain their political base.
Right.
But there is another name we need to consider depending on how the election goes. You know, if Hillary comes back in, we get Bill Clinton, one who was and who is not and yet who is again.
Oh, not him again. So well, he is wildly popular, though. He really is. I mean, maybe
he is.
Right now there's a cloud over him because of the Jeffrey Epstein thing. And, you know, that's bad. You know, that's really bad. You know, that's just like a mark of shame, you know. But, you know, Bill Clinton is also kind of old and feeble. You know, he's not that old, but he's kind of feeble for his age. And so.
Sure he is.
So we'll see. You know, I don't know. And, you know,
I'm just trying to say that it can come anywhere. It can come from anywhere is what point where we least expect.
Do we have to have this
with such deception that he's going to.
Mm-hmm. Do we have to have that? Charles, do we have to do? Is there any way? OK, to me, it looks like on the line, on the path I'm on. That it just seems like it's I'm on more of a I mean forgive me for this has always been my problem. That's what I always got criticized for by my teachers, everything else. Here we go, head in the clouds, Zeph. I just feel like I'm going celestial. And I'm all tied into that today. I don't know how long that's gonna last, but I just don't really feel like when we talk about these, you know, prophecies that are very legitimate, and because there's been so many confirmed already, so why wouldn't you pay attention to the rest of the story? But I feel like I'm I feel like I'm okay. I feel like I'm outside of it. You know, like I'm looking at it from the outside.
We are outside of it, Zeph.
Like this big drama.
We are.
That
we're a part of the living God.
I just don't feel
We're given the vision of God.
Yeah.
We're given the vision of God. We can see these things. We're not a part of them. We are above them. Mm-hmm. We are outside of them. They may envelop us as far as our body goes. One or both or all of us may die in the middle of all of this calamity.
Right.
But in any case, we're already outside of it. We're already above it. We may even witness our death and never even feel it because God takes us away at that instant. Like you said, these things happen all the time.
That's what he told me. He said,
they always have happened.
I'm just walking out. You know, I mean, I'm just, I have a certain destiny, and it may not be the same as everyone else, but I do not really fear death. I mean, I've come close a few times because I was really naive. I didn't think people would try to poison me and stuff, and, you know, they do. They actually do. They do stuff they do stuff like this. I can't believe it, how short-sighted that is, though. You know, they try to hurt us, and they don't understand that, you know, first of all, number one, they need the lambs around. Otherwise, they wouldn't be here. I mean, that's just like a, you know, 2 + 2 = 4. And they already know this inside of themselves. They already know that they're parasites. You know, they know they need to feed on the living, and they know they need, you know, so you know, then they want to kill all the children of God, and then God would put the wrath on them. So, you know, the wrath being drawn from their own hand, actually, they're actually killing themselves. If you really want to, you know, sum it up, they're actually, you know, the there doesn't need to be any army against them. They're doing themselves then. Right? Because they cut off the...
Well, of course. That's the way it's going to wind up.
They cut off the children of God, therefore they're committing suicide.
That's why death is their God.
Right. Death is their God. They're going to get... And they're going to finally...
That's why death is their God.
Right. But they're trying... It's almost like they're having a scorched earth policy. In other words, they want to take these quantum computers and this and these CERNs and whatever else. They got a few of them around the world. Probably a lot of really nasty stuff underground, too, that we don't know about. And they want to extinguish. They want to blow up all the planets. They want to take God's creation and destroy the entire thing. If they can't run it, then they want to take us all out. And that's their attitude, which is, you know, obviously a stupid, because if you're not the creator, you can't create. I mean, Satan can't create. He has to take what God created and twist it, right? He can't create, you know, from whole cloth, anything. And so doesn't it make sense that he would stop and go, you know something? This isn't working. Don't you think? Eventually, at some point?
Well, yeah, it's a clear sign of the end. You know, we all are aware of the physical characteristic called entropy, how things wind down.
Yeah.
And this is a cognitive atrophy that's setting in their minds that mirrors this physical entropy. And like I said, it's a clear sign of the end of the age. The Bible talks about this. There will be a great increase of knowledge, but a complete lack of wisdom, a cognitive atrophy. We have tools at our command that we no longer understand how to use. And this is going to bring on our own destruction.
They always warned about technology because we use technology unwisely and therefore it comes back on us.
We use it
for evil purposes. We're terraforming the earth, you know, for whatever future new world order. Part of it involves terraforming, and that terraforming, we use planes with, you know, chemicals coming out the back as a way to manipulate weather.
Yes.
So the weather will terraform the earth. And they've been so
it's even in the simple levels, Zep, even in the simple levels, it's coming upon us. You know, there was a time when all of us could go through our math tables of 12 instinctively. We could remember 100 different phone numbers. But now technology has replaced it with the calculator, the phone, and all of this. We don't even remember basic things that we used to know by instinct. It's because we're being dumbed down. This atrophy causes us to not even notice the fact that our grandparents were far more intelligent than we are. And our children,
Well, you're very... No, I beg...
It's almost a basket case unless we intervene.
So what's your excuse? You're a lot more intelligent than most people. How did you... escape the dumbing down?
Well, first of all, you and I were both educated in a time when we were still taught to think, back in the 50s and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, when we were broken into God, we were lifted up by God, and God gave us a new consciousness, a new curiosity, a new intellectual ability. These things fight against this cognitive atrophy. As a man, I'm probably as stupid as everybody else, but in the spirit, I have the knowledge of the living God.
I'm stupider than everyone else. I mean, you know, in terms of earthy things, I'm really pretty naive, and, you know, I just haven't spent a lot of time with that, you know. And, you know, I call it street smarts, call it, you know, worldliness, whatever you want to say. It's the realm of Satan. I'm no expert, but in God...
Sure, how invested am I? I live in a 50-year-old trailer, and I drive 20-year-old cars, and I don't even care.
Well, because you're not really...
Know,
you're not.
I'm just here.
You're here, but you're not... You're visiting here. You're not really... You know, this is not your home, obviously.
Yeah. I,
So
whatever. I'm here, but I'm not there, I suppose, or whatever, however you want to put it.
If you want to be there, if you want to be with God, then you can't really be here. If you want to be here, you can't really be with God. So it's just, it's a decision has to be made. And I didn't even make the decision.
That's right.
All I know is I got an ass whooping pretty much from the Lord. I mean, I was all out of even self-destructive bullets, which is hard for me since I was such an expert at destroying myself. But when I finally, you know, when I finally gave in, I finally quit fighting God. I finally said, yes, oh, God, help me. You know what I mean? I had that, oh, God, please help me. I have no other move. I would just kill me or help me or kill, do something. Lord, I need you, please.
Yeah.
And he was there.
Yeah. And right, then you jumped into the light.
I jumped in.
And then you jumped into the light or into the fire.
I sure did. He had
everything changed.
He had a test for me. I saw him as the Shekinah. And that was just this all-consuming fire.
Yes.
Okay, and then he says, "Jump on in," like it was a pool, yes. Like a pool. And so I did. I did because I'll tell you why I did. I knew that was it. You know what I mean? You know that I wouldn't be me anymore. I knew that. You know, but the thing is that there was nothing left on the earth in my life. Everything was broken. All the relationships were broken. All the, you know, I was broken. Everything was broken. There was nothing to go back to. It was a wasteland for me. So I dove in instantly.
That's right.
I dove
That's when
in.
The fire comes.
I dove in immediately. And he goes, "You passed."
Yes.
I passed the test. You didn't think even for 1 second about it. You didn't look back. You just leapt. You just jumped in. I said, "Yeah, I just want to be with you."
That's right.
I just want to be with you. That's all I want. That's all you want. That's all anybody wants.
And the light never leaves. The light never leaves. It never goes away.
Yeah.
Never. You're always in that light.
Well, I thought it went away.
That's
there was a lot more.
That's the difference, Seth, between us and them. That's the difference in a nutshell.
There was a lot more challenges.
If we knew how to get them to the light, it would change. But that's not for us. That's God brings and God draws. We only shine.
Well, I can tell you one thing. There was still a lot of trouble after that. You know what I mean? I mean, there was, but the Lord said, you know, you everything's really messed up. You need me to guide you out of this mess. And he did. But it was a real mess. I mean, there were Satanists all around me plotting my own death. And they were just,
sure.
They felt they had their, they felt they had me.
Because now you're in the fight, you see. That's the thing. Now you're in the fight.
Yeah,
now
they all,
you're a threat.
They all
Before
came,
you jumped in the light, you were nothing.
Yeah, well, they all came out of the woodwork like on that day, the day after that. And it was amazing. They were right there with sabotaging. They sabotaged the motorcycle I had. I started just giving stuff away that, you know, well, I don't need to ride a motorcycle. Who cares? You know what I mean? It's got nothing to do with me. I mean, before I wanted the bike, I guess, because it was cool to have a bike and fun to ride around on it. But see, the desire for those kinds of things left. And so we had a friend.
Yeah.
And that he liked bikes. And I thought, well, here's a good match. So it's really making him a really good deal so he could take it home and really, you know, because that's what he always wanted was a bike that I actually customized it. And you know, it's really nice. But you know, the mechanic had put or somebody at his shop put a little nail in the tire, not so that it would puncture right away. But then we got on the freeway after picking up from the shop. Trish is on the back, and we're going about 70 down the 101 freeway toward, in the valley. And pop, bam, the rear end starts swirling. I'm going, oh my God, you know, and just right there, that moment,
yeah,
all the traffic just seemed to go away and we gently moved off for 70 miles an hour. And the back tire was a custom tire, not what the Indian bike was supposed to have. It was like, it was a rim, you know, like a custom rim. And it was a real wide tire that was, you know, untested in a situation like that, is my point. And, not to specs. Anyway, it fishtailed a little bit, but then there was usually the street is jammed. I mean, traffic everywhere. So we gently got out to the next lane, and then we gently moved over to the shoulder. And then we called the mechanic, and the mechanic looked freaked out as the mechanic came and picked us up, put the bike on the flatbed. took it back to the, like, they kind of knew what happened. You know what I mean? There was this weirdness after that. And so I didn't know where to go to get the bike worked on anymore, because I thought, are all these motorcycle shops going to kill me, or what's exactly going to happen here? I mean, are all the motorcycle shops dedicated to killing people? Are all the motorcycle mechanics murderers? Is that what it is? And the answer is, yeah, they might be. They certainly might be. Anyway, we survived it. We drove around.
Only if you're a lamb.
Yeah, we drove around because they feel they're going to get a reward. I mean, people will kill for anything. I mean, they'll kill if they think they get an extra 50 cents. So, you know.
Sure they will. Life is cheap. Life is cheap in our world now. matter of fact, death is worshipped, as we said earlier.
Well, anyway, so I went back to the mechanic. I kept querying them to see if they knew something. You know what I mean? Like, I was such a weird situation. And then eventually we came to New Mexico, and then I got rid of the bike. I almost got another head-on collision, and I was like, you know, I've ridden the bike around. I've had some fun with it. You know what I mean? The most interesting thing about the bike was, mm-hmm. is when I bought it, I couldn't ride it because it was this giant, you know, Indian bike. It was like a big Harley. And, you know, and I had, this guy was trying to teach me how to ride the bike. And I'd already had my experience with God, you know, after I bought the bike, after that I jumped into the Chicane, after that whole experience, I got the bike then. And I couldn't, the lessons the guy was giving me, I just couldn't get with it. You know what I mean? It was just like, I just couldn't get with the bike. So the Lord got me up in the morning and said, I'm going to take you on a ride. We're going to jump on the bike and we're going to just go on the freeway. So I got on the bike and rode down the hill, got on the freeway. I was driving around. The guy that was my teacher, who was kind of a believer, but he was like going back and forth. And sometimes he would stab me in the back, and then other times he'd be nice. It's just weird. Anyway, I saw him out on Victory Boulevard, for those of you familiar with L.A. And I was driving down Victory. And he pulls up next to me, and he looks like he's pale as a ghost looking at me. He goes, what the, WTF, right? What are you doing on that? What are you doing riding that thing around? I said, God took me on a ride. He taught me. He said, you know how to ride already. I jumped on. Boom, there we go. And it just, he was dead. I think that probably, if he's listening, I know sometimes he has, but that probably, that moment when he saw that, I think, and he knew I wasn't kidding. He knew it was real, you know, because he's a guy I know pretty well. So at the same time, down at the motorcycle shop, I mean, there was this some weird stuff going on down there, too, at this place that they were. In fact, everywhere I went, it got weird after that. You know, it was like they were all on the other side, and they're all trying to figure out how to get me. You know what I mean? And so everywhere I went was this war.
Yes.
Everywhere I went, like Guitar Center and to the drum thing, there was a war there. I described that a couple days ago. Okay, down to the motorcycle shop, there was a war there. Okay, into the grocery store, there was a war there. Like, they knew me. I was like, do you know me? Are you watching me on closed circuit TV? What the hell's going on around here? All that started happening, you know, and then eventually led to, son, you need to leave Los Angeles because it's no longer safe. No longer safe.
You know what it is. You know what it is. See, when you go in to the light, the fire of God, you become a possessor of the not only the power of God, but of the freedom of God. And they fear the power of God, but they hate you because of the freedom of God, because they don't possess anything like it. They're trapped. They're slaves into what they have to do, and they hate the fact.
Well, they also
that
see
it, free.
But don't they see me
and
as a traitor?
Work in you.
They see me as a traitor, though, too, right?
Yes,
because I was. I should have been on their side, but look, I rebelled, right, by going with the Lord. I say, look, I didn't rebel. I was nowhere, you know, you had me on the ropes. You guys have almost had me finished off, and God lifted me up. So they must hate God, and then anyone that represents God, they want to kill them because they hate God, right?
It's the hate and the fear, the combination of the two. You know, they have no other response, you know. They're in awe. They're in fear. And fear genders hatred when you can't make any other response, when you feel helpless, powerless against it. And that's where they are. You know, they can't do anything to any of us without God's express permission. And they know that.
And if they help us,
that hatred and that fear.
And if you guys can overcome your fear, you know, because I know you all listen, you all spy on me all the time. I know you're out there. You might not hear this for a month, but you're out there. Well, if you're nice to the, if you bless the lambs, the Lord will bless you. Why can't you try that for a change?
That's right.
That's the way.
Well, they're afraid of that too, you see, because that brings its own kind of reward from their side.
Right.
You know, then they get judgment and they get brought in line, you know, or maybe even taken out, depending on what they do. So, yeah, it's the fear. That's what holds them together. It's at the hive. It's held together by this fear and the fear of death. Mm-hmm. That's all they have.
Well, it's a very strange world. I mean, you know, I woke up into this world. I had no idea this whole thing was so structural, you know, so kind of cut and dried, you know. No idea that it had, you know, the hidden rule book was so specific. No idea that the Truman Show was so real. And then, you know, over the last 15 years or 20 years or so, you know, 18 years, I guess. I don't even know how long anymore. But, I'm a late bloomer in terms of, you know, I guess I came here, you know, and I fought everybody. I fought the devil. I fought God. I fought everybody. I fought, and you tell me, you give me an idea of, you tell me what to do, I'll do the opposite. I just was going to be I was reluctant to even come here in the first place. But I finally...
I recognize that spirit entirely.
You do you? Okay. Well,
yes.
So you're a fighter, too. You fought everything. You fought everyone, by Jove. And it led to disaster.
Everybody that could. You never saw anybody like to fight as much as I did.
Okay. So that winds that winds us up. We both have, I think, been incarcerated. Or am I mistaken on that? Have you... lost your freedom before?
Yes.
Okay. Well, okay. So
I lost my freedom.
Me too. So
even took a trip on Con Air once.
Okay. Okay. So you understand. I mean, you see where all of it leads.
Oh,
And then God uses that to break us, you know, those experiences that are very painful. And then finally, I gave in. Finally, I just said, Lord, okay, you know, I love you. I need you. I want you. I love you. I just please. And, you know, and then I haven't looked back, you know, I went, that happened in, I guess around, I'm not quite sure if it was 1999 to 2000, but it's in recent history. You know, I mean, it's not like, well, I've been walking with the Lord since I was 15. No, I've been fighting with the Lord since I was, you know, 3. And,
yeah.
That was stupid. I fought him. I admit I fought the Lord, but then the dark side didn't want me because they knew I belonged to, I was a prodigal of the Lord, not of Satan. And I think the people of Satan, they recognized that in me. And then that's why there were so many, you know, dangerous or violent incidents before I had, you know, given myself totally to the Lord. There were also attempts to take me out and things like that. Mainly from Satan's side, because I wasn't really, you know, I was kind of naive to the whole thing or in denial or in psychological trauma. So I just couldn't accept the world. The way I saw the world was, you know, kind of like, you know, like Disneyland. I mean, I hate to keep using the same cliche, but I saw it just like a TV show. And I couldn't let go of that because they all... I had a lot of trauma, like I say, you know, I knew about another world that was so awful, I couldn't look at it. And all these people, all these friends, so-called, and family members and extended family members and friends of my parents, all these people they were all kind of coming at me like they were all in another world, but I wasn't. And I fought them, you know, I fought them and they fought me back. And they, terrestrial wise, they won. I lost, but then I wound up with the Lord. So I really won in the end. You know,
yes.
It didn't, whatever whatever doesn't kill me makes me go to the Lord. Right? Doesn't make me stronger. What doesn't
kill. It does. It's a microcosm of each one of us and our experience. We all go through that. Each one of us. Situations might be different, but the experience is always the same.
Well, you wonder when you start seeing them coming at you, and they're coming out of the woodwork, and they're people you thought were cool, and then all of a sudden, oh man, you know, they're not. People you thought you trusted, and you thought they were, you know, and then they turn out to be like on that side too. And then you just feel all alone, you know, like you have no help and no friends, and they want you to corrupt yourself into their whatever, their world, W-H-I-R-L-E-D. You know, into their whirlpool.
Yes.
And you're like, I can't believe
we would be doing a disservice. We would be doing a disservice if we didn't tell people that these things are painful. That we do feel these stings and these arrows. We do indeed. They hurt. They are why we are the way we are now. I don't go out many places. I don't.
No. Why should you? Because
people have been the biggest source of. They've been the biggest source of pain in my life.
Yeah. If they're waiting for you,
Dad. Very solitary. Other than.
Yeah.
What's that?
If they're waiting for you, you know, down, you know, at the local store or whatever, you know what I mean? Or there's always a painful experience. Eventually.
Sure, they are.
You just quit going there. I mean, you know, that...
You do?
You know, that. Unfortunately, I hate the guy that owns... I don't hate him, but I mean, I dislike the politics of one Jeff Bezos who owns Amazon. But I love Amazon, too, because I'm sorry he's so successful, but dang it, it you know, I go there and I don't go out. You know, I mean, that's just a natural shit.
Sure.
I've been shaped... by the world, because I can't be something I'm not. I can't be nodding and winking on Satan's side and act like I'm some kind of Christian or something. I can't even imagine how one the amount of work that would go into. I mean, you talk about an actor training for a role. What about that? That would take a lot of training to be like on Satan's side and basically, and you know, on the dark side, and then. And then going to church and like doing Bible study. I can't even, how would that, that would kill me, you know? What about you? What do you think of that?
It would be like living a lie. It's a difficult thing to conceive of. I tried living that lie, you know, when I worked in the church. I could see things that were going on. I could see what was going on around me, and I wanted God. And the combination of my trying to live that lie and being afraid that they would see me, that I couldn't live the lie, wound up in their attack on me that almost destroyed me. That, you know, they sent me, I came in one day to the seminary and I had a swelling and all of a sudden felt sick. And they sent me to one of their hospitals right around the corner. They diagnosed a spider bite and gave me a whole concoction of chemicals. And within a day and a half, I was sitting there thinking of how to kill myself. The visions were so vivid. And finally, I got scared to the point that I actually ran into the bathroom and threw all that stuff away. But it had done its work in my mind, and it destroyed certain cognitive abilities. And I began to not be able to make rational judgments and all of this. And for years, I was in and out of this state until God reached out and healed me in 98.
Oh, man.
And lifted me back over.
And
terrible. That was their attempt on taking me out. But it didn't take me out. It just put me in the cracks, which is where God wanted me anyway, because he wanted to seed something in me.
We were both going through it.
Somewhere dark where it could grow.
I got poisoned in 1997 where I got it. Hey, how do you like war stories, folks? Okay, there is a little bit of, you know, we're a couple old soldiers here, right? So, you know, we do have a few stories.
Yeah.
And I've carried around like an ulcer thing that I had was given in 1997. And I remember, I know exactly who did it, how, what, where, and why of it. And I'm sorry it happened, but it's been a thorn in my side ever since. And the Lord says it's not going to kill you, but you're going to have to live with it. You know what I mean? And it was like, and I wondered, well, why do they do that? And the story I got back was this. They do that because the frog decided to give the scorpion a ride across the river to the other side. And when they got over to the other side of the river, the scorpion stung the frog. And as the frog was dying, he said, why did you do that? And the scorpion says, because I'm a scorpion. What do you expect? And that was
that's what I do.
And that's what the person responsible, that's what they told me.
Yeah.
And
he was actually, that was a moment of honesty that you rarely get.
Well, he just figured I wouldn't know what he was talking about. You know, I was dumb as a box of rocks. It would go right over my head, you know? And, you know, I'll never figure out that he was the guy, you know, but I did. And it's just been an odyssey of, you know, a true odyssey, like Homer in the Iliad and the Odyssey, right? It's been an odyssey,
yeah,
like Odysseus or something, you know.
It's been an adventure.
It's been an adventure
for sure.
Yeah. But you know, when you're in a war, you get winged, you get shot, you know, I saw the guy that was, he was on the air yesterday. They aired the Benghazi 13 hours. It was on Fox. Highly recommended. It was Brett Baer, who's actually redeemed himself in my eyes with this interview. And one of the guys, you know, if you saw the movie 13 Hours, he got his arm shot up so bad that it was basically falling off, and it still doesn't work right. And you could see him struggling with that arm. And the three guys who basically saved, I don't know how many people they saved, hundreds, really, who had to all by themselves, you know, defend that that embassy in Benghazi. It's quite a story, and Brett Baer did get an excellent interview. It's on YouTube, I think, also, so it's really highly recommended. It's a warning, you know, it's a tearjerker, so you're gonna cry, you know. But boy, to see Hillary Clinton running for office, after seeing that and after watching those men, the real guys that were there, that were such heroes, you know, who laid down their lives for their friends. I mean, that's an act of love right there. And I just.
It is.
I can't watch anymore. It's just one of these kind of incidents after another, and Obama and Hillary, and they all just seem to, like, nothing ever happens. You know, they could kill anybody they want, have people hacked to death, false flag attacks, and they just go play golf and they have their parties. I don't get it. I this is way out of my depth. Your thoughts?
Well, it breaks my heart when I see what we've become as a people. It truly does. That this woman could even secure a nomination.
I know.
It would have been unthinkable even for, but yet today that she has every likelihood of winning. And it's hard to imagine what will become of this country. In some sense, I suppose I'm glad that I'm kind of old now.
Yeah.
You know, yeah,
we may not.
I am definitely. If I have any fears, it's for the fears for what my children and grandchildren are going to grow up into. Should we not live long enough to see the consummation of things?
That would be a blessing not to see the consummation of things. I don't think we are going to see the consummation of things. I think we will somehow, one way or another, we will not be here. And but I'm seeing.
I agree with you on that.
I'm seeing something, you know, whether it's catastrophe coming, whether it's, you know, yesterday I had a vision of some kind of planetary event where we had some kind of a comet hit, you know, or come by or something like that. I'm not saying it's any kind of prophetic thing. I'm saying, you know, it was strong. You know, it's like when I usually get something, I don't promote it so much, but you know how I get a little tiny thing. So there was this, it was hitting the Earth. And it was like answering my question about the Mandela effect. Like, could we be, you know, experiencing things because we're on the precipice of death? And I'm sorry, I have to bring that up to you, Charles, because this has been on my mind for about the past month, I'd say.
I think I would agree with that, Jeff. I think we're on the precipice of the death of one realm, one world, and the opening up of something altogether different. Mm-hmm. And I think that these things are part of a natural process that we're going through, trying to recognize this, trying to deal with it, because we are still, even if we have the spirit within us, we're still men. And we have all the emotions and everything that goes with being a man. And I think this causes problems with us as the ages are changing. And we sense this. We can see what is coming, but we can't see it so clearly as to reassure us in every part of us. And so it causes this consternation, this uncertainty, this unsettledness within us. And that's why we need the power of God to get us through. Yeah. We're as much a part of this as anyone else.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, this is it. So it's the idea that something happens, you know, and we're experiencing all this because it's, you know, when there's about to be some kind of catastrophe, you know, there's been things in the physical world. And if you look back in time, you know, big earthquake, you know, you have evidence of things like UFOs or, you know, other anomalies, you know, things you might see someone that you thought was dead. Now they're alive walking around, you know, just the fabric of reality starts changing as it's about to be annihilated. You know what I mean? Things pop
That's
out
right.
of the woodwork to tell you something is going to happen, something big. And that's kind of what this is. But at the same time, I have an excitement about it because it means the end of this. And I've never been a big fan of this. Some people may be, but I'm no fan of, you know, aging and death and, you know, not being able to hold on to anything and rocketing through time and space. So you don't ever get to stop and enjoy anything, right? You just, before you know it, you're old and die. That's it. You know, poof. And I'm just like, no, come on. There's got to be more than that. And if that's what it is, okay, you know.
Yes.
But it just feels to me like this, these Mandela effects, these quantum effects, and all the things that I've been looking at are the supernatural coming right out into my face indicates something. But now that big thing may not be just mass extinction. Maybe it isn't. But it's extinction, I think, like Charles, what you said, of this world. That this thing that we've had,
yes.
this order we've had, it just seems to be coming apart at the seams.
It is coming apart at the seams.
It's palpable.
You know, all their structures they have built are beginning to collapse. You know, if you look back, all of the systems that we use today, the systems for control, banking, government, military, all of these were begun at Babylon. And the natural
right.
entropy of any system means it must begin to disintegrate from within as it ages. And we can see that now. We can see they're moving money around from here to there, these printing money that has no base. All of these things are measures of desperation, trying to keep a sinking, disintegrating ship afloat. And they're simply not able to do it. And that will bring in the chaos. That will, when they throw their hands up, that's when something else is going to take over entirely.
I wonder how much more time there is. Have you given that any thought?
I do, but you know, they're conflicting thoughts because, like everybody, I'm trapped within these doctrines that I learned coming up, you know, about times for this and times for that. But yet, the times seem to be moving so fast that I think that it's going to come upon us before we think it's going to happen. I think it's going to be sooner rather than later.
Okay.
Although, you know, that doesn't mean tomorrow, but I just, it seems to be gearing up. Things that used to take, like you said, 10 years are
yeah.
happening in a week.
Exactly.
And so I see something ramping it up even faster. And I think it's going to come upon us with the suddenness of a violent storm. Just 1 minute it's clear, and the next minute you feel the wind, you see the clouds, and then all of a sudden it's on you. I think that's the way it's going to come.
And that's what we've been told it's going to be like, too. And so it's not like we haven't been warned.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay.
No, we've been warned.
Five wise virgins out there, be the five wise, don't be the five foolish. and all you that listen here, you're already the wise virgins. We know that about you. You know, you wouldn't tune in here if you weren't. And I think, you know, just like the Bible gives good advice on everything, the other good advice, don't fear the guy that can, you know, kill your body. It's really that who can destroy your soul. You know, that it's the Lord that we must fear, not the things of.
Amen.
They try to show us this hacking bit in Bangladesh to get us to be afraid. That's why they show it on the news all day long. They're trying to show us these barbarians going around like any minute you could be, you know, and they know what effect it's going to have. People are huddling in their houses thinking they're going to they're going to be next. And they want something done about
it.
They are. And this is all by design.
And that's what they want.
That's what they want. They just want everyone afraid so they'll vote all all their freedoms away. And, you know, why do they need a totalitarian regime? Because they want the Book of Revelation to come to. They want to be the pale horse. You know, they want to bring sickness, death, and executions to as many people. They want to fulfill the Georgia Guidestones, 500 million people maximum on the planet. That would be like 7 billion people executed. You know, yes. That to them, that would be the most ultimate, you know, zinger of a sacrifice ever. That would make them in so high they would never come down almost, but they will. I mean, but that's, you know, they look forward to that. They love the Book of Revelation. Look at it from their point of view. Look at all the when the vials and the bowls are being, you know, hitting, you know, the masses, they'll be, you know, hiding away somewhere, enjoying themselves. Of course, the sixth seal is a problem for
probably
them.
Probably have remote control TVs so that they can have some kind of orgy while they're watching the death.
Yeah, but I that's right. There's the orgy of the death, but then when you're really advanced, you have to watch Disney films for orgies. You know, that's, you know, or children's fair for orgies, you know, innocent stuff. And then that's when you're really sick. Yes. That's when you're about as sick as that's when you get Charles Bronson out there at Death Wish. You know, that's when the vigilante should come for you. That's about when the lights ought to be turned out, because my God, how much worse do you want to be before? How much more do you want to embarrass yourself than that? You know, so yeah, the Lord laughs at these people and their orgies and their stupid crap they do and their stupid government.
Those people are already gone, Zeb.
I know.
They're already gone. They're just already gone. There's nothing we can do for them as much as we would like to.
Well, you know, when they put ISIS in your face and they tell them that make it look really bad so we could scare people with it. At that point, we're dealing with I guess what they need, God's going to do to them is just kind of like the wine press, you know, like he's going to, you know, like the tares, he's going to just burn the tares and they're just going to be folded in and they'll be as if they never were. And well, no one will ever remember them. We'll just go on, I guess, you know, I guess not every seed planted comes up. Yeah. You know, some go back.
No, that's what the word says. That's what our Lord told us. You know, as much as we would like to see 100%, it's just, I don't believe that will happen.
He will still redeem everything to himself, you know, but the form,
oh, yes.
But it may not be that, you know, that people that have crossed a certain line may just be redeemed to himself or reconciled to himself as matter. You know what I mean? As energy, not necessarily as a person.
As a being.
Yeah. As a sovereign being that is, you know, and that fusion with God, they've decided not to, you know, with this opportunity here, Earth is actually an opportunity. It's an opportunity to get right with the Lord, right? So it's a great gift. It, you know, people get, me included, of course, we all get distracted because we think, you know, gosh, it's so horrible. I'd love to get out of here, but we don't realize that it's a gift that, you know, we want to go through this to prove ourselves to God and to return to God. And it's the only method that we have.
Yes.
We can't just have a free ride back to God after falling and all that. There has to be, you have to put some skin in the game, right? There's got to be some kind of challenge. And, but I think.
Certainly.
Yeah, so. Anyway.
You know, we are his betrothed here to run that test of time between the betrothal and the marriage to prove our loyalty, our purity, our oneness with him.
Mm-hmm.
And we can only do that as we walk with him. That is the whole purpose of this walk, I think. I mean, everybody's probably has their own opinion on that. That's how I reconcile it and all the violence and evil that I see around me with the walk that I have, that I was sent here to somehow walk this life, to be made pure, to grow into what he would have me to be through his work. I think we all look at it something along those lines.
That's exactly the way I look at it. It's funny. You just spoke my own thoughts. that's amazing how we all have the same thoughts, isn't it?
It is. You know, really, that there's that poem I wrote years ago, Till Now, was kind of about that, how we all have these memories, these things that give us an identity in Him, and they're beyond our existence because we can't place our finger on them, but yet they're there, and their reality is compelling. And I think that's a part of what unites us as a people. Certainly in our lives in this world, there's very little that would unite you and I. We grew up totally different circumstances in different parts of the country. I mean, Columbus, Ohio, Los Angeles at all, they're whole new worlds. But yet we walk together in another living. Mm-hmm. And in that, where we are one, we are together, and we do know each other.
In the real world.
That spills over once we get to know the living God. Yes.
Yeah, in this world we are.
And that's how we are friends.
Yeah. Well, yeah, yes. But that makes sense to me because, you know, in this world, so we're brethren regardless of background, regardless of age, regardless of our social status, our wealth or poverty, whatever. It doesn't even matter our skin color, our anything. We just,
none of that matters.
We exist as brethren in the real world, and this external world that we're in, it doesn't matter in the end. It's not really what's going on. What's going on is we tend to flock together, right? Birds of a feather. We tend to flock to our own. And we tend to have an understanding about, you know, it's so funny. I talk to so many people and they, you know, it's like talking to myself 10 times in a row, you know, I love it. You know, I love it. It makes me really happy. It makes me really happy. It makes me feel like this is all worth it. You know, it makes me feel like, you know, that you got to step out and see there's other people out there every once in a while, you know, not just, I think that's why I went with the live speaker thing. So I would know there are people there and I could tune into the chat room and I could see there's real people there that are sharing the same thoughts and emotions and things about God, the world, physics, I guess now is our big topic. And so many things about death and dying, which is another very important topic about philosophy. It's like we're just all, you know, where did we all get indoctrinated? Where on earth did we get indoctrinated? Nowhere.
To some extent, we fell here to be indoctrinated. We're almost like, you made some military illusions earlier. You know, it's like a squad in going into combat. We came here and we trained, and when the fight comes, now we can act like a single living organism within that fight. We don't react like 12 different people. We act like one living being, and that is our strength, and that's why this fight is already over, even though they can't see it.
Well, they're coming apart. They're not. They don't look like they're cooperating with each other anymore like they used to, but we'll just have to keep our eye on it.
No, and they can't.
Well, Charles, I want to thank you. It's Kunita's Ramble, folks. Kunita's Ramble at Podomatic.com, right?
No, it's on Spreaker.
Oh, I'm sorry. Where am I? I'm living in a... that was bad. That's there you go.
Find a blank page over at Podomatic.
Okay. At Spreaker, like we're at Spreaker. Okay, we're all at Spreaker. All right. So here we are at Spreaker. And Kunita's Rambles at Spreaker. Go look them up. You know the usual, the people out there that are, you know, God raised, none of us wanted to really be speakers. God raised us up to speak. And then, because you needed someone to listen to, and we needed, you know, so that speakers are speaking and you guys do what you do out there. We all are doing what God has us doing and strengthening the body. I mean, they're not, you know, was your aspiration to become a broadcaster, Charles? No.
If you ever listen to me speak, you'll know that was never one of my career goals. But I'll tell you what happened. The same thing happened to you. God fills you up to a certain point, and you're about ready to bust, and you got to let it out. There's just no other alternative.
No, you know? That's true.
That's kind of the way I was. I had to share it because I was just, like I said, it was so full, I was about to bust myself. So I thought if I didn't cry out, something else was going to. So I started and... Boy, it's been going on. I never thought I'd be doing it for this long. It's going to be 7 years here pretty soon.
Okay, let me get the applause button.
It doesn't seem like that long. What's that?
I have applause running. You can't hear it, but they can. Applause for your 7 years. You know, I mean, we've been at it. It's not like, but we weren't, but do you have a career? No, I don't. You know, we're just,
no,
we're in the desert. We're just wandering across. I see the desert as more and more. Oh, I can hear it now. Trish is in the chat room and she's, I can hear the applause on her. it's funny. There's like a little delay. She's over there. I could hear the show going on with a delay. Sounds pretty good, actually. So, any parting thoughts for?
This has been a great talk this morning.
It's yeah, we hit it.
It's just been a fantastic talk.
We hit it right straight, just smack dab right where it needed to be hit. Whether that's the hornet's nest or we hit the ball out of the park or something, but God wanted us to talk about all this stuff and in the context of Him. And I'm so excited. Why? Well, I know it's a home run for me. I mean, I'm not rating that like the world rates it. I'm for me personally because I got so excited about.
I understand.
About God today. I just could see these.
Yes.
I could see the windows of heaven opening up, you know. I could just see the time-space thing, you know, fading away. I could see what we really are, and I can't describe it to you, but I could see it. I could see all that, and I could experience it. I can't put it into words, so I'm not going to try, but it was just like that excitement of where we're heading, and it just so overpowers the fear we could have about, you know, end times Bible prophecy and all those things, which are quite frightening, actually. So I thank you for being here, Charles, and for being
there. I think God smiles, Zeph, when we see the gifts that He's prepared for us, and we begin to glimpse that reality, and our hearts start to beat, and our imaginations begin to run wild. I think He smiles at us, and I think He enjoys that within us. I think it brings Him pleasure in the way it brings us pleasure, maybe even more so.
Well, yeah, because we want Him to be our God and us to be His children, and that's all we want, you know, and that's what He wants us to want, and that's what everybody wants, and that's what we want. So everything lines up. It's just joy on steroids. Okay, Charles, stay right there. Folks, that's gonna do it for the Zeph Report today. And, you know, we'll be talking to Charles, Kunita's Ramble, and Govinda and others. I got some other people I want to talk to as well regarding this situation that we're in. And I don't know, you know, the it's a very fluid situation, to say the least. But stay right there, Charles. I'll be right back at you. And I think we're going to go with this one here.